From Los Angeles, this is Democracy Now! Swedish prosecutors have dropped the investigation into allegations of sexual misconduct by WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. But could he still be extradited to the United States if he steps foot out of the Ecuadorian embassy, where he's been holed up for close to 5 years? We'll speak to human rights lawyer Renata Avila. Then to the war on drugs.
We know that drugs and crime go hand in hand. They just do. The facts prove that's so. Drug trafficking is an inherently dangerous and violent business. If you want to collect a drug debt, you can't file a lawsuit in court. You collect it with the barrel of a gun.
As Attorney General Jeff Sessions vows a major revival of the war on drugs, we'll speak with Susan Burton. She spent 15 years cycling in and out of prison after her 5-year-old son was run over and killed. She began using drugs to self-medicate. Now she's written a book about her life experience, Becoming Ms. Burton, from prison to recovery to leading the fight for incarcerated women.
I believe in rehabilitation, not only for drug addiction, but for other areas. And we cannot continue to warehouse people and not provide levels of rehabilitation, reentry services, training, jobs, and allow them to be an asset and add to this economy in America.
We'll also speak with Michelle Alexander, author of The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. She's described Susan Burton as a modern-day Harriet Tubman.
We have got to build an underground railroad for people returning home from prison. An underground railroad. Courageous people like Susan Burton have been doing this work for a long time. She's building the underground railroad. But we all need to take part in that.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. In Sweden, a prosecutor Friday dropped the investigation into allegations of sexual misconduct by WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. Assange has always denied the allegations, which he has called a pretext for his ultimate extradition to the United States to face prosecution under the Espionage Act. Since 2012, Assange has taken refuge in the Ecuadorian embassy in London. It's not clear whether he will emerge anytime soon. WikiLeaks tweeted Friday, quote, UK refuses to confirm or deny whether it has already received a U.S. extradition warrant for Julian Assange. Focus now moves to UK, end quote. Last month, U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions confirmed that the U.S. has prepared a warrant for Assange, calling his arrest a priority. In Washington, D.C., President Donald Trump assailed his critics Thursday over a series of scandals that have rocked his administration, calling an investigation into alleged ties between Russia and Trump associates a witch hunt. Speaking at a White House news conference alongside Colombia's president, Trump said he respected the Justice Department's decision to name a special counsel to the investigation, but denied he personally colluded with Russia.
Well, I respect the move, but the entire thing has been a witch hunt, and there is no collusion between certainly myself and my campaign, but I can always speak for myself and the Russians, zero.
Asked if he urged former FBI Director James Comey to close or to back down on the FBI's investigation into Trump's former National Security Advisor, Michael Flynn, the president responded flatly, no. The statement directly contradicts a memo Comey drafted after a Valentine's Day, that's February 14th, Oval Office meeting, in which Trump reportedly asked Comey to end the investigation into Flynn's ties to Russian officials. On Thursday, The New York Times published new details of Comey's interactions with the president before Trump fired him on May 9th. The Times reports Trump called Comey weeks before his inauguration, urging him to state publicly that Trump was not personally under investigation. on Capitol Hill. House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi said Thursday she's worried the White House could try to influence newly appointed special counsel Robert Mueller as he investigates possible ties between Trump officials and Russia.
I'm concerned that Director Mueller will still be subject to the supervision of the Trump-appointed leadership at the Justice Department. We must remain vigilant to protect the integrity of the Mueller investigation. A special prosecutor cannot take the place of a truly independent outside commission that is completely free from the Trump administration's meddling.
Robert Mueller was appointed by Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein after Attorney General Jeff Sessions claimed to have recused himself from the Russia investigation. On Thursday, Rosenstein briefed senators in a closed-door meeting. Afterwards, Democratic Senator Dick Durbin said Rosenstein revealed that he wrote a memo recommending the termination of FBI Director Comey after Trump had already decided to fire him.
Fire Comey before he wrote that memo?
He didn't go into detail on that, other than to say on May 8th he learned that the president was going to terminate Comey.
Rosenstein's memo was dated May 9th. Last week, President Trump contradicted his staff's account of Comey's ouster, telling NBC News he had decided to fire Comey regardless of the Justice Department's recommendations. President Trump leaves for the Middle East today on the first overseas trip of his presidency. His first stop will be Riyadh, the capital of Saudi Arabia, where he's expected to announce a $110 billion arms deal. The agreement was brokered by Trump's son-in-law and senior advisor Jared Kushner, and Reuters reports it could see as much as $300 billion in weapons sold to the Saudi monarchy over the next decade. The deal comes as the Pentagon continues to support a Saudi-led bombing campaign in Yemen, where years of fighting has decimated Yemen's health, water, sewage and sanitation systems. The UN says around 19 million of Yemen's 28 million people need some form of aid, with many of them at risk of famine. In media news, former Fox News chair and CEO Roger Ailes, who molded the network into a vast right-wing media empire, died Thursday at the age of 77. Ailes resigned from Fox News last July after he was accused of sexual harassment by more than 20 women, including Fox News anchors Megyn Kelly, Andrea Tantaros and Gretchen Carlson. Fox ultimately paid out $45 million to settle the claims. Ailes began his career as a Republican Party operative as a consultant for President Richard Nixon. Over the decades, he advised other Republican presidents, including Ronald Reagan, George H.W. Bush and Donald Trump. Trump has called Ailes a friend and defended Ailes after the sexual harassment allegations. Back in Washington, the FCC voted 2-1 Thursday along political party lines to begin a process to replace net neutrality rules that were adopted in 2015 to keep the internet open and prevent corporate service providers from blocking access to websites, slowing down content, or providing paid fast lanes for internet service. In response, Free Press President Craig Aaron warned the proposal would take away the rights of internet users, saying, quote, "The federal courts rejected this kind of approach twice when the FCC tried it before." Meanwhile, an award-winning reporter is speaking out after he was attacked and forced to leave the Federal Communications Commission headquarters Thursday, all for trying to ask a question. John Donnelly of CQ Roll Call said he tried to ask FCC Commissioner Michael O'Reilly a question after a news conference had ended. But two FCC security guards reportedly pinned Donnelly against the wall until O'Reilly had passed. Donnelly said O'Reilly witnessed the incident and kept walking. Donnelly is chair of the National Press Club's Press Freedom Team and president of the Military Reporters and Editors Association. He issued a statement after the attack saying, quote, I have been working as a reporter in this town for years and dealing with the top leaders in our government every day. And in the hustle and bustle of press scrums, I've never been in a situation where simply asking a question was treated as a crime. In Washington, D.C., newly published video shows Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan looking on as members of his security detail assaulted a group of peaceful protesters outside the Turkish ambassador's residence. The violence left 9 anti-Erdogan protesters hospitalized. It's not clear if Erdogan gave the order for the attack. Among those assaulted were American diplomatic security officers assigned to protect Erdogan's delegation. Police briefly detained the assailants, but released them after learning they held diplomatic immunity. The assault came shortly after Erdogan was welcomed to the White House by President Trump. During the meeting, Trump did not mention Turkey's deteriorating human rights situation, which has seen nearly 50,000 people and 150 journalists arrested since a failed coup last summer. In Syria, U.S. warplanes bombed a convoy of pro-government militia members Thursday in what appears to be the Trump administration's third attack on President Bashar al-Assad's forces. The Pentagon says it ordered airstrikes after the convoy came too close to a zone where the U.S. and British troops are training Syrian rebels. The assault drew fire from some lawmakers, including California Democratic Congressmember Ted Lieu, who tweeted, quote, "If true, this is frickin' illegal. Trump does not have congressional authorization to attack Syria, a country that has not attacked U.S.," unquote. In Brazil, tens of thousands of protesters took to the streets of Rio de Janeiro, Sao Paulo and other cities Thursday, demanding the resignation of President Michel Temer over a corruption scandal.
"We want Temer out, and not just him. We want everyone who is corrupt out as well, because this Congress is a group of thugs. It is not worth it just to make Temer go, to then have Congress put up another person in his place."
There are growing calls for Temer's impeachment after the newspaper O Globo reported the president was secretly recorded approving hush money payoffs for a powerful politician jailed on corruption charges. Temer Thursday refused to step down, even as Brazil's Supreme Court released the audio tape and said it was investigating him for bribery of a potential witness.
"At no moment did I authorize anyone to be paid so that they'd remain quiet. I did not buy the silence of anyone, for a very simple reason, exactly and precisely, because I am not afraid of any testimony."
Brazilian President Temer said he should remain in office to help end Brazil's recession, the longest in its history. The claim came as Brazil's stock market halted trading early Thursday after it plunged by more than 10% on news of the corruption scandal. In Venezuela, National Guard troops used tear gas and water cannons Thursday as anti-government protesters marched on the Interior Ministry in the capital, Caracas. Across town, medical workers evacuated 3 newborns and 1 pregnant woman in labor from a maternity hospital besieged by opposition protesters. It was the latest violence that's seen 53 people killed in protests since opponents of President Nicolas Maduro took to the streets demanding an early election. In Washington, President Trump said the U.S. could intervene in Venezuela's political crisis.
"We will be working with Colombia and other countries on the Venezuelan problem. It is a very, very horrible problem. And from a humanitarian standpoint, it is like nothing we've seen in quite a long time."
On Thursday, the Trump administration announced sanctions against 8 members of Venezuela's Supreme Court after they ruled in January that opposition party members were in contempt of the Constitution and removed them from power. President Maduro has accused the U.S. of supporting intent by opposition parties to mount a coup. In Greece, the parliament on Thursday narrowly approved a fresh round of austerity measures demanded by the nation's creditors in exchange for a bailout. The deal was backed by Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras, whose Syriza party campaigned on an anti-austerity platform.
"We feel that we are on the final step. Nobody is denying, nobody doubts that this agreement has difficulties. However, it does open a path in front of us.
Outside the Greek parliament, anti-austerity anger boiled over into protests. Police fired tear gas to beat back a crowd of more than 10,000 people demanding a new government.
There is no other solution but revolution. They have taken everything from us, and these pseudo-leftists are finishing us off. The only thing we can do is resist and revolt.
The government must resign immediately. The people demand their resignation.
The latest round of austerity will see taxes rise and pensions slash further. Eurozone finance ministers will decide Monday whether to disperse another $8 billion in bailout funds. In Fresno, California, police are investigating the murder of 34-year-old Imer Alvarado as a possible hate crime. Alvarado was found dead of multiple gunshot wounds several blocks from the Fresno gay bar, The Alibi, early Wednesday morning. Police described Alvarado as a transgender woman, though friends describe Alvarado as a gay man. Alvarado's killing is the 11th reported murder of a transgender or non-gender-conforming person in the U.S. so far this year. And U.S. Army whistleblower Chelsea Manning Thursday tweeted the first photo of her new look as a free woman after serving 7 years in men's-only Army prisons. The photo shows Manning wearing a black top, lipstick, and mascara with the caption, "Okay, so here I am, everyone," and the hashtag, "Hello, world." While in custody, Chelsea Manning spent years battling the Pentagon for the right to transition to a woman, winning the right to hormone therapy treatment in early 2015. Although President Obama in January commuted her 35-year prison sentence, Manning is the longest-held whistleblower in U.S. history. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in Los Angeles.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez here in the New York studios. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show with news from Sweden, where a prosecutor on Friday dropped an investigation into allegations of sexual misconduct by WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. Assange has denied the allegations, which he calls a pretext for his ultimate extradition to the United States to face prosecution under the Espionage Act. Since 2012, Assange has taken refuge in the Ecuadorian embassy in London. It's not clear whether he will emerge anytime soon.
WikiLeaks tweeted Friday, quote, "UK refuses to confirm or deny whether it has already received a U.S. extradition warrant for Julian Assange. Focus now moves to UK," end quote. Last month, U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions confirmed the U.S. has prepared a warrant for Assange, calling his arrest a priority. For more, we're joined by Democracy Now! Video stream. Renata Avila is with us, a Courage Foundation trustee and human rights lawyer. She's been advising WikiLeaks and Julian Assange under the direction of Baltasar Garzon, the former Spanish judge who has indicted Augusto Pinochet, Osama bin Laden, Bush administration officials, and many others on human rights grounds. Renata Avila, welcome to Democracy Now! Thanks for joining us from Berlin, Germany. Your response to this stunning news out of Sweden.
I cannot hide my smile, to be honest. It is such a week to celebrate. It is a week to celebrate this small victory, but in this long road to free Julian Assange and all the people working for WikiLeaks. But it will finally help us lawyers to focus on the main issue, which is the persecution, the political persecution, and imminent prosecution of Julian Assange in the United States. So we are ready now for the battle to defend his right to publish. It was a long overdue decision from Swedish courts. Even the United Nations told them to do so more than 1 year ago and declared his detention arbitrary. But now, finally, for second time, we can say that he is innocent in the Swedish system. He has never been charged of a crime, and we hope that this will help people to focus on the issue that matters in this case, which is our right to know and his right to publish.
And Renata Avila, what about this issue of a possible U.S. Warrant for Julian Assange? Is there any responsibility on the part of the government to advise you or any of his other attorneys about the existence of a warrant of such kind?
Well, we know how this operates. I mean, the investigation of WikiLeaks against WikiLeaks and Chelsea Manning, it was all kept in extreme secrecy. So it's a secret grand jury. We can know only when this notice is served. And we suspect that it's already there. I mean, if you remember in the Stratfor emails revelations, there was a confirmation of an indictment. In emails shared privately among those private intelligence persons, but we have over the time through Freedom of Information requests found vast evidence of this investigation. But I mean, it is clear from Sessions' statements, and it is clear from Pompeo's statements that it is imminent. And but now the battle that we have to fight here is the right of asylum. Julian Assange has been granted asylum by Ecuador. It's a sovereign nation, and it is a practice by any state, any democratic state, to grant asylum to people politically persecuted. The political persecution is clear, and now it is a balance. Will the West be willing to not respect asylum and therefore risk all the potential people that they want to protect just to get Julian Assange? Or will they respect the human right to asylum? That's the question that we have to answer in the following months.
Renata, NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden has called on Donald Trump to drop the U.S. government's investigation into Julian Assange and WikiLeaks. He joined more than 100 other activists, journalists, government workers in signing an open letter from the Courage Foundation to President Trump that calls prosecuting WikiLeaks, quote, a threat to all free journalism. The letter asks the Department of Justice to drop plans to charge Assange and other WikiLeaks staff members and reads, quote, if the DOJ is able to convict a publisher for its journalistic work, all free journalism can be criminalized. So if you can respond to this, Renata, and also what happens now? Has the Ecuadorian government responded? And what about the British government? If Julian Assange steps foot outside, he is not wanted by Sweden, will the British government arrest him?
I will answer the last question first. The UK is refusing to respect its international obligations, and they say that Met Police issued a statement saying that they will arrest him. They will arrest him for a minor infraction on jumping bail, but it is a misunderstanding because he didn't jump bail. He didn't stay a night in the house under house arrest because he needed to exercise his right to asylum.
We seem to have lost Renata Avila for a moment. She's speaking to us from Berlin, Germany, by Democracy Now! Video stream that is faltering right now. We're not sure why. So we're going to go to a break. We're going to see if we can get her back for a moment. And then we spend the rest of the hour on a fascinating new book called Becoming Ms. Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women. We'll also be joined by Michelle Alexander, author of The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. This is Democracy Now! We'll be back in a minute.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Come on, brothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry
down to the river to pray by Alison Krauss. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. It looks like we cannot get Renata Avila back on with us, one of the advisors to Julian Assange. She was speaking to us from Berlin, Germany, about this latest news that Sweden has dropped the investigation into Julian Assange, where a prosecutor Friday dropped that investigation into allegations of sexual misconduct. Julian Assange has always called this a pretext for the extradition of Julian Assange to the United States, and we'll be bringing you the latest through the weekend. As we turn now to the story we will spend the rest of the hour on. Juan?
Well, most women in U.S. prisons were first victims. It's estimated that 85% of locked-up women were at some time or were at some or many points in their lives physically or sexually abused or both. Disproportionately, these women are Black and poor. Those are the opening words of the powerful new memoir, Becoming Miss Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women by Susan Burton.
Susan Burton's book comes out as Attorney General Jeff Sessions is vowing a major revival of the so-called war on drugs. This is the Attorney General speaking at the Justice Department headquarters as he rescinded two Obama-era memos that encourage prosecutors to avoid seeking inordinately harsh sentences for low-level drug offenses.
Going forward, I have empowered our prosecutors to charge and pursue the most serious offense, as I believe the law requires, most serious, readily provable offense. It means that we're going to meet our responsibility to enforce the law with judgment and fairness. It is simply the right and moral thing to do. And we know that drugs and crime go hand in hand. They just do. The facts prove that so. Drug trafficking is an inherently dangerous and violent business. If you want to collect a drug debt, you can't file a lawsuit in court. You collect it with the barrel of a gun.
Sessions has long backed lengthy prison sentences and mandatory minimum sentences for drug crimes, including for marijuana use, which is now legal for either medical or recreational purposes in many states. Sessions' escalation of the so-called war on drugs was met with widespread outcry. NAACP President Cornell William Brooks said in a statement, quote, "The Attorney General's directive suggests that this long, ugly era of mass incarceration now has eternal life. The racial disparities in arrest, prosecution, and incarceration have led to the devastation of African-American families and communities."
Well, our next guests today know this devastation all too well. After Susan Burton's 5-year-old son was run over and killed by an off-duty Los Angeles police officer, Burton fell into a deep depression and a 20-plus-year cycle of drugs and incarceration. She found her way to a rehab program in 1997 and made it her life's work to help other women reenter society after incarceration. The foreword of Becoming Ms. Burton is written by another leading voice in the fight against mass incarceration, Michelle Alexander. She's the author of the best-selling book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. We're thrilled to have her back with us today. Michelle Alexander, Susan Burton, for the first time, it's great to have you. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Susan, let's begin with you. The title of your book is Becoming Ms. Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women. Tell us your story.
Amy, I was born in the housing projects in East L.A. and struggled most of my life to become. Struggled for stability, struggled for safety, and it wasn't until October 4th of 1997 I found that after many, many years of abuse, suffering, and then finally the death of my son, which led to my substance use and incarceration. But the journey after, you know, October 4th of 1997 is when I was able to stand up and come into the community and fight for not only my right, but the right of other women to come back and have a life that is just not survival, but offers a lane to thrive.
Well, in your book, you talk about it's a very powerful—I mean, I was reading it last night. It's a very powerful book in terms of the personal relationships within your own family, the community, the support groups that you had, and how you felt for many years that you had failed so many of these folks who had provided you support. But you also talk about how the impact on your family of your father's yes. loss of work and the deindustrialization of Los Angeles and yes. the effect that that had on you, on your family and the community.
Yes. So my father, you know, he was a great family man, and he took us to the drive-in every weekend. And, you know, him and my mother came to Los Angeles running from the racism of the South. And they settled in the housing projects, or rather, they were directed to this area, is what I understand now, where they could be contained, suppressed, and surveilled. And, you know, my father, they began to, the industrialization of America, and my father lost his job. And with that went much of his esteem and his proud, I'm the, you know, breadwinner and I'm the family man. And, you know, we know that until things like the deindustrialization and unemployment hits white America, you know, it's a problem that, you know, you're lazy, you don't want to work, you have no skills. So, you know, that's part of what I capture when I describe my early years and my mother and my father and our family.
Can you talk, Susan Burton, about 1997, about how, after just several decades of the cycle of addiction and imprisonment, you found your way to a rehab center, and what happened there?
Yeah. A friend of mine told me about this rehab center in Santa Monica, California, and, you know, I arrived there October 4th of 1997, and what I found there, I stayed in this rehab for 100 days after six prison terms, 100 days in a rehab, and, you know, this was a wealthy beach community, and there was this huge buffet of services that I was able to, you know, partake in, just anything I wanted. Therapy services, recovery services, clothing, job, medical, dental, mental health, just everything. And it was delivered in such a friendly and opening, warm way. And in that community, what I found is that people arrested for the same things that I was arrested for was not sentenced to prison. And I thought, what is this? You know, why are we treated so harshly and other people given help, given a pass, given a court card, given diversion programs, sent to rehab instead of to prison? And I began to really look closely at, you know, the difference in being black in America and white in America, being having income, having wealth, and not having wealth, and where that left us. And that was one of the driving factors that had me come back to South LA, where our community had been devastated by the war on drugs. So many women were sent away to prison. I came back there to create what I found in Santa Monica, but I didn't have the wealth, you know, and my skin was not white, but I did have the commitment, a little of the anger to get the job done.
Michelle Alexander, I'd like to ask you first how you first came in contact with Susan and your decision to write the foreword for her book. And I'm wondering if you might even be willing to read the opening graphs of your foreword as well.
Sure. I would be happy to. You know, it has been such a privilege and honor to know Susan. You know, I met her shortly after I published my book, but I had heard of her sometime before. I actually stumbled across an interview with her while I was doing research for my book. And in that interview, she described so clearly and so powerfully and with such deep conviction what it meant and felt like to be a second-class citizen in this country because you've been branded a felon. And she described what it was like to check the box on employment applications, housing applications, and to be denied even food stamps because you've once been caught with drugs. And I came to learn that she had founded several safe homes for formerly incarcerated women in Los Angeles, and that she was helping to birth a movement led by and for formerly incarcerated people who are demanding the restoration of their basic civil and human rights. And after I published my book, she invited me down to L.A. To visit the homes that she created and to do an event for me. And when I got there and saw these homes and met the women, I was just blown away by what Susan had created. And she's been a profound inspiration to me, and I believe this book will be a profound inspiration to millions of people, particularly those who have themselves found themselves ensnared by our criminal justice system and are struggling to make a way out of no way. Susan has made it possible for hundreds of women not just to survive in this era of mass incarceration, but to find a path to thriving and to see that they, too, can be movements, leaders in this movement for justice.
So if you could read for us the opening of your foreword. It's...
Okay. There once lived a woman with deep brown skin and black hair who freed people from bondage and ushered them to safety. She welcomed them to safe homes and offered food, shelter, and help, reuniting with family and loved ones. She met them wherever they could be found and organized countless others to provide support and aid in various forms so they would not be recaptured and sent back to captivity. This courageous soul knew well the fear and desperation of each one who came to her, seeing in their eyes all the pain she felt years ago when she had been abused and shackled and finally began her own journey to freedom. Deep in the night, she cried out to God, begging for strength. And when she woke, she began her work all over again, opening doors, planning escape routes, and holding hands with mothers as they wept for children they hoped to see again. A relentless advocate for justice, this woman was a proud abolitionist and freedom fighter. She told the unadorned truth to whomever would listen and spent countless hours training and organizing others, determined to grow the movement. She served not only as a profound inspiration to those who knew her, but as a literal gateway to freedom for hundreds whose lives were changed forever by her heroism. Some people know this woman by the name Harriet Tubman. I know her as Susan.
Those are the words of Michelle Alexander in those opening three paragraphs in this stunning new work, Becoming Ms. Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women. Michelle, before we go to break, how you see Susan's story fitting into this larger narrative, the way you have framed your book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness, especially in the era of Trump?
Well, I think when you read Susan's story carefully, you see that it's not only a story of individual trauma and struggle, survival and heroism. It's also a story that explains how a system has been born in the United States that criminalizes people in the era of deindustrialization and globalization that has criminalized individuals, families, and communities, locking people up who are now deemed disposable, their labor no longer needed, their services no longer required in the current economy, and how we have chosen to treat drug addiction as a crime rather than a public health problem, and how the literal war that has been declared on poor people and people of color has led to the birth of a prison system unlike anything in world history. You know, if Susan Burton had been white, if she had been solidly middle class, she would have had access to legal drugs that would have helped her cope with her trauma and depression following the death of her son. But instead, Susan had no choice but to turn to illegal drugs and self-medicate herself. And when she was arrested and released onto the streets, she forced a legal faced a legal system of discrimination that kept her locked out of jobs and housing, denied her access to food, and ensured that she, along with millions of others, would cycle in and out of prison, potentially for the rest of her life.
Susan, I'd like to ask you your response to the foreword that Michelle wrote, to her comparing you to Harriet Tubman, and also the how her book had an impact on your life and on your understanding of your own journey.
So I can't get through the foreword without tears. I'm touched very, very deeply the way in which Michelle wrote that. And while I embrace it to be real and true, it just touches me very, very deeply, like a tear is falling right now. Mm-hmm. Much of what Michelle wrote in The New Jim Crow allowed me to examine more deeply my life, my family's life, my mother's and father's life, to understand what happened, how my family, my mom, and my mom and father's dreams got dismantled, their hopes got smothered with deindustrialization, with racism, with the treatment that they had prior to coming here. I remember my father talking about the hanging in trees, and you know, he had that horror, you know, that came with him. I can remember how my father never was able to look white people, white men, in their face, and you know, this all drowned and dismantled, derailed their hopes and dreams, this systemic oppression, racism, and no value of the black man or woman in America. So Michelle's book, as I flipped the pages, you know, I began to understand more about my life and the life of black people in America and this cruel, really cruel system that we have that drives people into being criminalized, entire communities criminalized.
We're talking to Susan Burton. Her new book, Becoming Ms. Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women. And Michelle Alexander, author of The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. We're going to go to break. When we come back, after Susan Burton came out of prison for the final time, we're going to talk about a new way of life the nonprofit that she's founded that provides support and housing for formerly incarcerated women. Why Michelle Alexander calls Susan Burton the Harriet Tubman of our time. Stay with us.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, they can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road to love. Still, I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we dance till three, the way you've changed.
They Can't Take That Away From Me by Ella Fitzgerald. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in Los Angeles, headed to Santa Fe, New Mexico, then Arizona and Houston tomorrow. And Juan Gonzalez is in New York.
Well, we're spending the hour with two leading voices in the fight against mass incarceration. Michelle Alexander, author of the best-selling book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness, and Susan Burton, founder and executive director of A New Way of Life, a nonprofit that provides housing and other support services to formerly incarcerated women. She's the author of the new memoir, Becoming Miss Burton, From Prison to Recovery to Leading the Fight for Incarcerated Women. I want to go to a clip from a short documentary by the digital channel WIGS about Susan Burton and New Way of Life. This is Angela, who was released from prison just 11 months before this was filmed.
They drive you to the bus station and, you know, they give you $200 and they buy your ticket out of your money and put you on a bus. And you're just headed to wherever. And so I arrived downtown L.A., and it was really scary. It was really scary. And I looked like I came from prison, you know. I was dusty looking, you know, with jeans and a paper bag. Everybody knows that you're from prison. They know. Just by the way you look, and they know. You got approached by everybody. There were people asking you if you needed a ride, telling you that you look fine. Drug addicts, people living that life, and you know they are. It's so easy to get lured, especially if you're scared. And I'm going to be honest, I was scared. And I felt like I was just standing there buck naked. I didn't have any place to go. I really didn't. And I called Miss Burton, and I told her, I said, I received a letter from you, and you said for me to call you and that you would pick me up. And she says, where are you? And I told her, she says, I'll be there in about 15 minutes. And she came and picked me up.
That's a clip from a documentary about our guest, Susan Burton. We are also joined by Michelle Alexander, author of The New Jim Crow. So, Susan, talk about this new way of life, your nonprofit, and what it is that you're doing with women who are coming out of prison right now.
A new way of life is a safe house that women can come to after they're released from prison in South Los Angeles. It's a place for women to detox the trauma, the torture of incarceration, be welcomed and embraced and live and begin their new path to if it's recovery or receiving mental health services, go back to school, get their children back, whatever their goals are, we support them to obtain those goals. You know, it's criminal that we spend $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 a year to incarcerate someone for minor drug charges or petty crimes, and then put them on a bus and send them back into Skid Row without ID, without government papers, after years of torture and trauma inside of a prison system, and say, go make a life for yourself, and give them that $200 and nothing else. It's criminal and such a waste of not only financial resources, but human potential. I've seen some of the most amazing women with just a few months of support come back and actually their lives soar. They become organizers. They become caregivers. They become mothers again. They become, you know, social workers and drug therapists and just all types of walks of life, you know, hairdressers, just fit back into the community. But without that support, once they leave those gates, all that potential is just wasted. It just goes down the drain. So from what I received in Santa Monica, California, and my goal to transplant it back into South LA, you know, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people have been touched and lives changed, hope and inspiration given back. And, you know, what I believe and have witnessed is that, you know, women are the glue of our community. You know, we put the Band-Aids on, we hug the kids, we raise them, we bring that love into the community and that grounding foundation. And when you come through a community like South LA, and you just criminalize the entire community and just suck all the women out of it, you know, that community hurts and bleeds as a result of it. So my goal, my hope, is to actually repair that damage from the war on drugs and replant the women back healthy and whole and able to function and put those Band-Aids on their kids' knees.
I want to ask Michelle Alexander, there appeared to be some hope in the last few years that the country was finally beginning to turn away from mass incarceration, especially when it came to drugs. And now we're seeing under the new Trump administration, we heard what some of the stuff that the new Attorney General Jeff Sessions says. Your reaction to where the country appeared to be heading and where now the turn that it's now taking?
Well, I think it's clear by the rhetoric coming out of the Justice Department today that they are committed to reviving a warlike mentality towards poor people and people of color. And I think we need to respond forcefully with as much courage and compassion as we can muster in these times. You know, a few decades ago, politicians were banging the podium, calling for law and order and get tough and declaring war. And our, you know, television sets were filled with images of crack mothers, crack babies. And a literal war was unleashed on communities, war that devastated the lives of people like Susan. And families and communities of color nationwide. Well, today, the enemy has been defined as those brown-skinned immigrants sneaking across the border. And, you know, Donald Trump has banged the podium, you know, saying we must get rid of them. Yes, claiming they're getting—
He was yesterday with Colombia.
Yes, claiming they're bringing drugs and that they're murderers and urging our nation to get rid of them all. You know, that war that was declared on drugs decades ago gave birth to a private prison system, gave birth to the system of mass incarceration. And if we had risen to the challenge of the war on drugs the way that we could have and should have, the system of mass deportation would not exist today. The private detention centers that are locking up immigrants today wouldn't even exist but for the drug war that was waged with little resistance for decades in this country, and that birthed a prison system, you know, a penal system unlike anything that this world had ever seen before. So I hope that we will learn the lessons that the drug war has to teach us and rise to the challenge this moment in history presents and build a truly transformational, revolutionary movement that will not only dismantle the system of mass incarceration and mass deportation, but will lead us to a new way of life. A new way of caring for one another and for our communities, and reimagine what justice can and should be in this country.
But, Michelle, that's not the direction, of course, of the Trump administration. Jeff Sessions, the Attorney General of the United States, just announcing an escalation on the war on drugs, going after drug offenders, people who are addicted. Can you talk about the significance of what this means, pushing for mandatory minimums, when there's been this consensus now? In many ways, across the political spectrum of the right, from the Koch brothers to Newt Gingrich to progressives who've been pushing for reform for a long time. What does this mean? What effect will it have?
Well, at the federal level, it'll have significant effect for those who are arrested and charged with federal crimes, particularly drug crimes, and who, you know, be facing years, perhaps decades longer than they might otherwise have, you know, before, you know, Sessions kind of overturned Obama's memo directing a slightly more compassionate approach. But there's tremendous movement in states and in communities around the country, in places like California and Ohio. I can, you know, go down the list of states and communities that are calling for legalization of marijuana, that are moving to declassify drug, you know, offenses from felonies to simple misdemeanors. There is momentum that will not be turned back overnight. And that's why I think it's important for us not only to see the necessity of, you know, continuing to build momentum to end the drug war, but to understand that the racial politics that gave birth to this drug war are the same racial politics that have given birth to the war on immigrants. And it's not simply a matter of building a movement to reform drug policy. It's about building a movement that will break the history and cycle of these racially punitive politics that birth systems of racial and social control in whatever form. And so I'm hoping that in the months and years to come that we'll see more coordination, more unity between the movements to end mass incarceration and the movements to end mass deportation. And come to see, it's the same struggle to define who is worthy, who has dignity and value, and who is disposable. And ultimately, we are trying to birth a new America in which each and every one of us, no matter who we are, where we came from, or what we may have done, is viewed as fully human, with dignity and value, and you know, deserving of inclusion in our nation, despite the efforts to distract and to divide and to elicit from us our most punitive impulses.
I'd like to ask Susan. We only have about 30 seconds, but is there any hope of your expanding your successful new way of life to other cities across the country?
The next stage is to actually identify areas in the country and develop a network of the model in which a new way of life has developed that successfully brings people back into the community. There's been a lot of interest, and I'm going to respond to that interest because all over America, we have found that women have been taken out of their homes, men have been sent away, and they need to be able to come back in successfully.
Susan Burton and Michelle Alexander, we thank you so much for being with us. Susan's new book is called Becoming Ms. Burton. That does it for the show. I'll be in New Mexico tonight, in Santa Fe tomorrow, in Tempe, Arizona, and in Houston. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.